this movement in the house becomes a kind of metaphor for search in a kind of labyrinthine space. It's just about all these, just about the thoughts about what it is. What is one trying to do? And this is the work itself in front of the artist. As I said, those spaces that he's trying to create. A self-portrait with mirror and camera. There is one face looking out. There is one figure looking in, which is the reflection in the mirror, which is then the real, which is not in the mirror, but the real self. Or is it something that is captured by the camera? So is it another representation? There is one representation in the mirror, there is another one that's captured in the camera. Now, between these various reflections, representations, there is self-portraiture. Where is that self? That is the kind of question one is asking oneself. You know, between these various multiple reflections, the self is somewhere shuttling again. Another one, artist with camera and brush. In the painting, the artist is in the act of painting, but he's applying the paint to where presumably the canvas is, but where the viewer is too. Another painting in that show called Erase, which takes forward the same thought. So the artist with his rag, presumably wiping out something on the canvas, and the canvas is where we as audience, as spectators are. Now, Velasquez posed this question 400 years ago. All of you must be knowing the painting Las Meninas, in which Velasquez stands in front of his work, looking out to where we as spectators stand. But we realize that he's not looking at us, but he's supposed to be looking at the subject. So here too, maybe he's looking at himself. Ranjit said something in mail to me about this, which I'd like to quote, because it captures again the viewer's position as the canvas on the easel to which the artist persona reaches out with brush, rag, phone, camera. The IU of artist viewer blurred. So is it the viewer that is being wiped, erased? Is it the artist himself that is being wiped, erased? This is an experience, for example, that I've had, and many of us would have had, in front of some strong self-portraits. For example, Rembrandt's self-portraits. One looks at the self-portrait by Rembrandt. What does one see? Firstly, one sees an old man looking at himself in the mirror. That is the first interpretation. Then it seems he is looking at us. You know, so he's looking at you. And then you realize that his looking at you actually makes you look at yourself. You start looking at yourself. So how does this transfer happen between artist and viewer? This is the kind of area that one is thinking about, just thinking about and trying to make paintings of, that kind of thing. This is a small painting called Enigma. Again, I said earlier about realism, that there is one kind of realism that is a project to actually create a realistic representation of the scene, what you see. In memory, in the paintings that are inspired by memory, one is not painting what one has seen or what one is seeing, but painting what one has imagined. And so, but one is using a realistic language, and here that language is used as not as a project for of representation of reality, but it is used as a means to express yourself, your imagination. You might use any other language. Some other artist would use another kind of language. So its purpose changes. Now here the question of what is real. That object you all know is an impossible object. It cannot exist in three dimensions. But here it looks convincing. It looks as convincing as the person. So if the object does not exist, cannot exist, could the person exist? So art is, in that sense, it's like that. You know, it's a lie, which makes us realize something of the truth, which is what Picasso said. So it's this enigma between the relationship between reality and art, and also between art and meaning. How do things mean something? How does art mean something? It's difficult to put your finger on it. You suggest, you evoke. So here there's an evocation of an enigma. This is something odd here. You don't know. I mean, this looks very real, but there's something not right. So that's the kind of thought. Okay, now to the last section, just three images. Gifts from the world. Now we saw, looking at everyday life, working your way through, letting it sink in, allowing it to grow within yourself, then thinking you want to make an image, and then starting working on it, being inspired by other works of art, thinking of structure, doing all this, pushing it ahead, pushing the image ahead. Memory, it's the same. You think of something, you have to work, you have to give it new meaning, you have to reimagine that memory in some sense. With all these things, there is this kind of work that has to take place. But sometimes, it doesn't happen often, but when it does happen, it's pure joy. Sometimes the world offers you gifts. And what that means is that you see something and it's there, it's done. It's a painting that you see. In one instance, you know this is a painting. I'm traveling in an auto rickshaw, construction site, a woman there in the evening from the drum throwing water on her face, washing her face. In an instant, this is a painting in my mind. All I have to do now to get back and paint it. I don't have to work at various things. This is the kind of gift that, of course, there are things that it might suggest. For example, as I start working on it, I remember a painting by Anju Dodia, in which a woman again holds her hands like that. So all these meanings get added to it, but the painting itself structurally comes to you in a flash. Another one, again, traveling along the road, suddenly a man with a baby in his arms crosses in front of you, jumps on the divider in between and stops for a moment, goes away. You know it's a painting, you don't know what it means. What is this? A man holding a baby. Is the baby crying? Is the baby happy? Are they playful? I don't know. It even suggests as if it could be sacrificial. All kinds of meanings can be read into it. But the painting comes to you as a gift. It's there. balcony. I'm in the studio. I go up to the window. I look out in the building opposite. There is this man standing. It's done. No need to take a photograph. No need to make a sketch. Of course, I will make a drawing before I do the painting, but not to work out structure, not to work out various things. Everything is given in that sense. When this happens, as I said, it's pure joy. Why is it pure joy? Because at this moment, you feel that there is a spontaneous connection that is made between the outer world and the inner world. There is a spontaneous connection between the inner and outer worlds that nothing can disturb. So that, unfortunately, they don't happen too often, but when they do, as I said, they are pure joy. Thank you.
May I start with the question? May I?
Yes.
So what is your inner world? Outer world, yes, we understand, but it'd be important to hear, I think for all of us, is what is an artist's inner world?
Yeah. Lakshmi has a habit of throwing the most difficult questions. Oops, sorry. One indication of, no, it's okay. Oh, sorry, yeah. One indication of that, as I said, was when you feel that you want to make something structurally like this, you know? So the structure hasn't come to you from outside. This is the kind of combination of forces that you want to make something out of. Now that is coming from inside, you know? So, as, for example, in Akbar, I think, you know, where did the structure of those mountains and valleys and things like that come from? You know? He is a person who is projecting all the time into the world. He's saying that, you know, this is the structure of the world that he's seeking, but actually it is the structure that he is giving the world. So similarly, the inner world of the artist at one level is the seeking to restructure the external world in one's own image, in that sense. Image is, in that sense, the way in which one wants to reconstruct the world. Then, of course, there are, like, as you said, with memories. With memories, there are so many, I mean, the emotional kind of scale of all that, how to live with all that, how to live with past lives, how to live with. So what does art, give you means to deal with that? I think it does. And in bringing memory up to consciousness and to projecting it into the outer world is one of the ways in which I have used that, you know. So realism for me is important in the works that I do from memory also, because it is, again, restructuring a memory. As I said, this is how I would have liked it to be. Maybe it was not.
Right.
As Faiz said, yu na tha, fakat chaha tha yu ho jaye. You know? So it's like that. So that is the inner world. And inner world is, of course, all those things. The witness, for example, the artist, the need to be torn, the need to suffer, and the belief that without that you will not be witness to the most transcendent beauty. That thought. All these are.
Your inner world. One more before I sort of throw it open. The notion you spoke very poignantly about the notion of romantic. So, I mean, and it's like, so the romantic is considered to be a word which is denigrated. Somewhat like transcendental beauty, which you just said, is how do you bring in notions, such concepts of beauty, transcendental beauty, as well as the romantic into today's contemporary discourse? Because I can see your references to Persian painting, so to Madonna on the Rocks. I mean, to all this. So these are resonances deep within you, which you are then, and you're bringing it to play in your structure. But how do you reconcile notions of transcendence?